massive event that affected all of culture at the time. It has to be the first successful slave revolution in human history. And the successful break from European imperial powers. And that's the Haitian War of Independence that breaks out in August 1791.
It's one island, originally colonized by the Spanish, who effectively abandon the western portion of the island, which the French squat on and eventually create their own colony on, which they call Saint Dominique. The other thing I think just to remember is that this was the most successful colony in the Americas. I mean, we think of it today as it's a poorest nation in the Americas. It's always talked about in those terms. At that time, it really was the richest site. It wasn't a nation of its own, but the richest colony in the Americas. The productivity was enormous. So for every, in a sense, empire in the Americas, in a sense, had their eye on it, would have loved to be able to take control of that sector of the economy. The beginning of the revolution happened really in the northern plain of Saint-Domingue, which really was this extremely industrialized zone in which there were these enormous sugar plantations. That's really where the revolution began, and I think that's important to remember as well, that these plantations, which were some of the most industrial sites in the world at the time, in terms of the combination of both of agriculture and production, generated this revolution, that it came out of these plantations. The first stage of the revolution in 1791 was essentially about the slaves establishing control over these plantation domains. They transformed these wealthy plantations into their camps. One of the most interesting things that African historians have suggested about the revolution is that one of the reasons it may have succeeded is that there were huge numbers of men who had served in armies in Africa, who had been soldiers in Africa, who had been enslaved as a result of after participating in wars in Africa, and they brought their military experience to Saint-Domingue.
1793, Britain and France went to war, and Britain saw a chance to do two things in one go: to seize this very wealthy territory for itself, away from its enemy France, and to suppress the slave revolt before it could spread to Jamaica, which was very close by. A huge British force headed for Saint-Domingue, and for 5 years they fought the rebel slaves there, who came under the leadership of Toussaint L'Overture, the great Haitian leader, and they lost.
The attempted repression of that revolt involved hundreds of thousands of English boys and young men who were shipped off to Haiti. And there they will meet, at the other end of a bayonet or the other end of a machete, the historic indignation of slaves fighting for freedom. And it's a huge trauma to the English people.
This was a case where an army of rebel slaves had defeated the army of the world's superpower, which was also the world's greatest slave trading nation. And it was a great shock.
The same can be said of the French, right, who have also, I mean, who later lost against essentially the same troops when they tried to reestablish slavery. The British defeat was, in a sense, presaged the defeat of Napoleon's troops that would follow a few years later. This revolution seemed kind of unthinkable for a lot of thinkers. I mean, the idea that this was happening, in some ways, the idea that slaves would become generals and leaders of a revolution and would defeat these armies, it was just really hard to kind of fit into what they believed and what they saw. Now, a lot of people, of course, did think about it and brought it into their reality. But I think it challenged at the time and continues to challenge so many of our notions about where history is made, how history is made, who are the central actors in history. This is really one of the foundational moments in the history of not just the Americas politically, but in democratic theorizing of philosophy, of thinking about what rights are. So not only do you have a challenge to racist ideas that kind of consign people to the margins of history rather than placing them at the center, but you also have to rethink, I think, a lot of broader narratives about Western history.
What's interesting about the Haitian Revolution is that it's the only revolution with the only constitution that outlaws slavery and outlaws discrimination on the basis of race. Now that is historic. That's not in the Bill of Rights in the US. It's not part of the unwritten constitution of the British Empire. But it's part of that history of opposing racism, which actually comes from the enslaved themselves, and not from the so-called humanitarian efforts of the abolitionist movement, which couldn't have been successful unless the slaves themselves were making slavery unstable.
Because they paid for it, it was a terrible one, because there was this international boycott of Haiti, and in the end they had to pay reparations. So it's not that reparations were paid to the slaves, they had to pay reparations to the French for property expropriation. appropriated and so forth. I mean, one of the reasons that Haiti is today the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere comes out of this, that, you know, they do this tremendous historical feat. So here's the only successful slave revolution in history. And basically, okay, we are going to make sure that the contagion of your example does not spread to the United States, does not spread to Latin America. We're going to isolate you, we're going to quarantine you, we're going to make you pay.
Slavery itself isn't abolished in the British Islands until 1833.